And I know sometimes we think you only God is sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the number one message.
Absolutely.
But we all got a message, right? John the Baptist had a message. What was his message? Repent. Right?
Right.
His message was repent. Moses had a message. What was Moses' message? Let my people go. We all have a message. We all have a message. Jonah had a message when he went to Nineveh. Well, that was before he boarded the ship to Tarshish, but he ran, right? Gideon had a message, right? And that's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about what our message is. Because, see, our message is not in these four walls. Sometimes we get hung up and we think we're just supposed to stay in the four walls. But this is where we get fed to some degree, right? We should be eating on our own too, but we come here to fellowship and to be empowered, and we come to be amongst other believers, right? And we feed off of each other, right? We should be, and we receive the word and we feed off the word, and then we go outside of the four walls and we share our message. But you can't share your message if you don't know what your message is. So what is your purpose, your message, your purpose? Moses had to go to Pharaoh and tell Pharaoh, let his people go. And can I tell you, when you go to deliver your message, it's not always going to be easy. It's not always going to be effortless. Because not everyone's going to receive your message. Not everyone's going to like your message. And sometimes we get a little fearful. Hence why Jonah said, I don't think so. I'm going to go pay my fare and board this ship, and I'm not going to do what you told me to do. I refuse to go tell these people what you told me to tell them. Don't you know what they're going to do to me? John the Baptist probably knew that at some point, I'm going to get hurt talking about the Messiah. At some point, these people are not going to like what I have to say. And when we go out to speak and to do what God tells us to do, some of people are not going to like to hear what we have to say. Especially when we're talking about Jesus. Especially when we're talking about living right. Especially when we're talking about letting go of the things that you've been doing that you know is not right. Where people don't want to hear that. People don't want to hear the truth. We want to be made free, but we don't want to hear the truth that's going to make us free.
Absolutely.
To hear the truth makes us accountable. And when we're accountable, it makes us responsible. And we don't want to be sometimes responsible people. We don't want to make those necessary changes. Amen? So I want you to ponder today with me a little while.
Hallelujah.
As you consider, what is your message? I know what mine is. God told me. My message is to tell the people, you are not what you've done. You are not what you've done. And so that's what I do. And how do I do that? I become vulnerable first before God. Because I have to let the people know that I'm not what I've done. We have a tendency to label people based on what they've done. Oh, you did this, that, or the other. And then we define you based on what you've done. If you've done anything bad in your past, I don't know about any of you, but I have. See, I'm not perfect. I'm not without blemishes. And if I were without blemishes, we would not have need for a Savior. We would not have need for the blood of Jesus that has washed us clean. You got to have some kind of dirt on you in order for you to get washed clean.
That's right.
Washes you and cleanses you, he says, now go and tell them what I did. Right? Go and tell them what I did for you. Go and tell them what I did. Revelations 12 and 11 tells us that, what does it tell us? That we overcame him first by the blood of the Lamb, then by the word of our testimony. So that in itself tells us there's a message, a testimony. I got something to tell you. So my message is, you are not what you've done. You are not defined by what has happened in your past. Women that go through domestic violence, a lot of times they're afraid to come forth because of guilt, because of shame, because of embarrassment. I can't tell nobody that my husband is beating on me. I can't tell nobody. I gotta make up the scars. And that's what we try to do. When we've done stuff in the past, we try to make up the scars with our makeup, with our clothing. We try to cover up the mess. But we can't do that. Because then it prohibits us from telling people what is really going on. I know a lot of us heard what goes on in this house stays in this house, right? We don't say nothing. We grew up with that. It's kind of like what goes on in Vegas stays in Vegas. But you got to tell people what God has done. If God has done anything in your life and brought you through anything, you owe that to Him.
Amen.
You owe that to Him. To tell another sister, another brother, what God has done for you. He's brought me out of the darkness. He's brought me out of sin. He's loosed me from my chains. He's broken the bondages that I was under. Do you know about this Jesus I'm talking about? Do you know who He is? Do you know what He can do for you? Look at me. I am a living example of what He's done for me. I'm a living example of what He can do for you. I am His. And guess what? So are you. That is a powerful message if you're willing to share it, if you're willing to tell it, if you're willing to stand boldly and say, I didn't always look like this. I didn't always talk like this. I didn't always carry myself in this manner. And I didn't do it because I didn't know who I was. I didn't know who I was because I didn't know whose I was, who I belonged to. I didn't know that I was royalty. I didn't know that I belonged to a king. I didn't know that my permanent residence is a kingdom. I didn't know that. So I was living beneath my God-given privilege. I was low down here living when God says, baby, I need you to rise up. Walk in your fullness. Walk in who you are. So again, I ask you, what is your message? We like to tell people, don't you know you can be saved by the blood of Jesus? Well, tell me how. Tell me how. You can confess with your mouth and you can believe in your heart, but people want to know, how did you do it? What did He do in your life? Well, you know, tell me how to walk this thing out. But we don't want to tell people that. I like what Apostle said when he said, I ain't got it together, in essence, what he was saying. You don't hear that often from men and women of God because we want to stand up here and act like we got it all together. Like we ain't never went through nothing. Like we have never doubted God. Like we have never feared anything. Like we don't have moments of weakness. Like we don't go through stuff. But I think if more of us stood up here and told the truth and became more transparent, more people would begin to come because we would appear to be unable to be reached. Sometimes we get so high that we forget how to go low. But none of us sit on the throne. Only Jesus does.
That's right. That's right.
So we have to be able to tell people the truth.
Amen.
So your message is important. You can share the gospel of Jesus Christ, but how do you do it? People are kind of tired of hearing, well, I need you to confess with your mouth and believe with your heart. Now that's word. And we use the word because the word has power. That's how we get to a place of redemptive, being redeemed. But understand that we also have to tell people how. As I said, what is your message? And don't allow the pain and the past of your fear of what you've done in the past to prohibit you. See, I almost did that. I was like Gideon. I was trying to pay my fare on anything that would take me far away from what God called me to do. I didn't care if it was a train, a plane, an automobile. Just get me away from whatever God has called me to do. Because I felt, as I said, inadequate. I can't speak to your people. You know why? Because I committed adultery. God doesn't use people who do stuff like that. You know why? Because I was raped. God doesn't use people who have been raped. I went through domestic violence. God doesn't use people who went through domestic violence. I lost my mother when I was 16. She was an alcoholic. I fought her boyfriend's wives at 13 to 16. God doesn't use people like me. I don't have what it takes, Lord. I never went to theology school, Lord. How am I, you really, me? Me, you're gonna use me. No, you can't use me. Everything I see on TV says I have to have all these degrees and certificates, and I'm not knocking that. That's important. What I'm sharing with you is don't compare your journey to someone else's journey.
Come on. Come on.
What I'm sharing with you is stop looking at what other people have done and determine what you can do. Their journey is not your journey. Moses' journey was different from Jonah's journey. Gideon's journey was different from David's journey. David's journey was different from Jesus' journey. All of them had different journeys, and all of them God used different methods and different ways, and he used them all differently because he created them all differently. So again, I ask you, what is your message? It's beyond the four walls, people of God. Somebody needs your story. We always say Jesus is coming soon. We always say we got to get the word out to everybody, to everybody. We're in a different season now. And people say, well, God is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. This is true. Again, this is word. But he's giving you a story. He's giving you a message just like he's giving me. Had I not gone through all of that, I couldn't be talking about being restored. I couldn't be telling women and men that you can do it. God can use you. Don't you know you have power? Don't you know you have authority? And don't you know you serve a God who knew you before he placed you in your mother's womb? So everything I did, God said, I already knew you was going to do that. And even before you did that, I called you to be who you are. I predestined you to speak to my people. I predestined you to tell them what I told you to tell them. Tell them what you did. Because when you tell them what you did, you can show what I have done. But if you don't tell them, how will you show them?
Okay.
You have to tell them for them to see the glory of God in your life. If I stand up here and tell you that God is good and he's merciful, you gonna say, well, I know that. The word tells me that.
Okay.
How is it reflective in your life? It's reflective in my life because he brought me through a mighty whole lot. I don't have a problem telling people what I did because I now understand it's not who I am. I am a daughter and a child of the Most High God. I serve a king who still sits on the throne. I serve a king who yet prays for me, intercedes on my behalf as he sits at the right hand of the Father. That's who I serve. And even greater than that is that's who I'm loved by. He loves me despite me. And every time I get to thinking about what people and as Apostle said, sometimes we don't want to admit that sometimes we get a little short on patience and tolerance. Sometimes we don't want to extend the love that was extended to us. Sometimes we don't want to extend the mercy that was extended to us. Sometimes we forget that it is by grace that we even hear still.
That's right.
And then when people fall short of our glory.
Okay.
They fall short of our glory. They don't measure up to our yardstick.
Come on.
We forget that we never have measured up to God's yardstick.
Okay.
He said, yet while you were in sin, He also tells us that he will give mercy. He will show mercy on whom he will show mercy. So every time I get a little short on patience, because I'm not perfect, and every time I get a little short on tolerance, I'm reminded by my King who says, remember, I did for you. I showed you mercy. He could have took me in my adulterous act. He could have took me when I was out there smoking weed. He could have took me when I was out there doing all that stuff that I know. See, because I knew about God from a child. I had a praying grandmother. And she 86 with dementia, and she still tells me, always trust in God. She may not remember my name, but she remembers her God.
All right.
I had somebody praying for me. We all have somebody in our corner praying for us. All of us. But sometimes we forget that God brought us through so we can go back and pull somebody else out. It is our responsibility to do that. To go and pull them out. To bring them out. To tell them your message. Oh, sometimes we want to run. Like I said, I did. I wanted to run. Because, no, Lord, don't you know what them people will do to me? And then what does he say in his word? Don't be afraid of their faces. Don't be afraid of their faces. When I read my word and I'm reminded of him telling Joshua, be strong and courageous. I always go, why did you tell them to be strong and courageous? Why did you tell them not to fear? If somebody tells you to be strong and courageous, that's an implication you're going to need some strength. If somebody tells you don't be afraid, that's an implication that you're going to come up against some stuff that's going to make you quiver in your boots. But he comes right behind that and he says, I am with you. I am with you. In other words, it's not going to be easy, Ciola, to talk to people transparently about you, what you've been through. But I am with you. Don't be afraid of their faces when they go to rolling their eyes and blinking their eyes and turning their heads and acting like they're not interested, or they're looking at you with a spirit of condemnation. How dare you? He says, remember, I am with you. Only be strong and of good courage. What you mean there's a bad courage? Be strong and of good courage. I am with you wherever you go. Wherever I send you, I am with you. Because I am sending you with a purpose. I am sending you with a message of redemption, a message of restoration, a message of healing. I want my people to know that I am here. I want my people to know that I am yet still loving you. I have not forgotten you. I don't care where you are. I want you to know that I'm still yet rooting for you. I am still yet sending people to pull you up from where you are. I am not angry at you. I want you to know that I have an everlasting love for you.
All right.
Do you know that he loves you where you are?
Yes.
Do you know that your message is important to him? Otherwise, he would not have given it to you.
That's right.
You owe it to him to tell people about the one who yet loves you, the one who yet raises you up every morning, the one who yet reminds you of who he is. He reminds you daily that he loves you, that you're important to him. Go and tell the people your message. God has given you a message. There is a message. I said, Lord, I'm 50 years old. Why did you wait this late? I was preparing you. His timing is not our timing. His ways are not our ways. His thoughts. Who can know the mind of God except the Spirit of God? But we have to be okay with his timing. What is your message? Do you know what your message is? We occupy these pews for far too long. We get comfortable in them. And God is saying, could you please get outside the four walls? I have people waiting on you. I have people attached to your life. And can I share a newsflash with you? It's not just your family. People, God has people out there waiting for you. I remember about 15 years ago, the Lord told me to do something, and he told me to look for a lady who was standing on the southeast corner, and that she would have red on. That's how deep God is, and that's how detailed he is. But you got to get in that place with him so you can hear from him that clearly. It's not just available to some of us, it's available to all of us. Whosoever will, let them come. He's waiting. What is your message? Do you know what your message is? Can you take some time to reflect and say, God, what is my message? What is it that you want me to tell your people? How do you choose to glorify yourself in my life? What do you want me to stand up and do? Where do you want me to go and share the glory of God? Tell them what I've done.